You brought us up into that realm of your presence and your glory, Father, that we can worship you and we can sing Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We thank you, Father, that you love us so much. That you love us so much that you bring us, Father, right before your presence to worship you and to fellowship with you, oh Father. Oh Lord, we love you. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. We worship you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Hosanna to the King. Oh, Hosanna. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy of the praises of his people. He is worthy. Oh, Father, we just stand before you right now. We thank you, oh God. We thank you, Father, for what you have done for us. Oh, God, that you have counted us as your children through the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Your praises ring out in the earth. Super. Let your people rise up and praise you and declare your glory. Father, throughout this earth, oh God, every nation of the earth, cause your people to rise up and be valiant and stand, oh God. And worship you, Lord. Worship the King of Heaven. And bring glory to your name as we open our mouth and we speak and we declare forth your glory. As we stand, oh Lord Jesus, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. And we declare the glory of the Lord. And we sing praises to the Almighty God. Hallelujah, that breaks every power of darkness, that destroys every wicked thing. Oh, Father God, may we shine bright. May we shine with the brightness of your glory, oh God. Oh, Father God, may your people, Lord, in this day, in this hour, where wickedness would seem to prevail, Father, let your people rise up and shine with your glory, your brightness, the light that is in you, that you have placed within us. Let that light shine from us, oh God, that people may see your glory in us. That turns back the tides of everything that the enemy would do, Father God. Father, I thank you that your anointing is more contagious than any work that the enemy would try to do. Father, if your people would just open our mouths, every one of us, and declare forth your glory. This anointing is better than life. And people are looking for this life and this anointing. And I thank you, Jesus, that your people will no longer be silent. But speak forth your truth, oh God. Speak forth your truth, oh God, everywhere we go. Lord Jesus, just be your light. Just be about your business, Father. Not counting our lives dear to ourselves, Lord Jesus. No longer counting our lives dear to ourselves, Lord Jesus. No matter what it costs, Father, we will declare your glory. We will sing of your praises. We will shout and be thankful to the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Oh, praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. You know, we can look and we can see the things that the enemy's doing in our nation. And we could become discouraged about the mess because it's running rampant. And now our government persecutes Christians. We're no better than North Korea, okay? Maybe we're not persecuting to that extent yet. But that's where the enemy wants to take it. And we can look. And we could be discouraged, or we can let God do valiant things through us. We can rise up and do valiantly. We can rise up and do valiantly. You know, he's not looking for you to get all fixed up and ready for him to use you. He's looking for you to yield yourself to him. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's just looking for you to say, here I am, Lord, fill my mouth. Lord, none of me and all of you. None of me and all of you. Just none of me and all of you. None of me and all of you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, people come up with all kinds of little good things to say to people. They try to figure out, you know, what am I going to say to people? I want to say something about Jesus. And, you know, I want to change things. But I tell you what, the Holy Spirit has more to say than what you can get out of your mouth.
Come on.
If you'll just say, Holy Spirit, speak through me. I'm willing to be your vessel in a dark world. I'm willing to let your light shine through me. I'm willing. Oh God, you bring the encounters. You bring the times. You bring the purposes. You bring the places. You bring the people. You work it out, Lord. Here I am. Holy Spirit, speak through me. Oh, praise you, Jesus. You know, when we're trying to do things of ourselves, thank you. When we're trying to do things of ourselves, we'll, you know, get in a struggle. Oh, God, what am I going to say? And how is this going to work? And we'll come up with all kinds of ideas. And it won't be like a river flowing. It'll be like, you know, I could have and should have and would have. But if we'll just go about our lives just worshiping and praising him and saying, Father, here I am, here I am, here I am, Lord, here I am, Jesus. You know, sometimes we'll get so busy with the things that we've got going on, and, you know, we'll feel like we're missing opportunity, and I haven't prayed enough. I haven't read the word enough. I haven't done this enough. I haven't done that enough. I. And we forget about him who lives on the inside of us. You know, he's not moving. He lives on the inside of us. He may be going over here sometimes, but he's living. He's dwelling on the inside of us. And don't you let the enemy tell you anything else. As long as you're saying, Father, I want to go deeper. Lord, I want more of you. Lord, you're my all in all. I don't want anything to do with sin, evil, and wickedness. Even if you get over there and get messed up because the enemy tricked you up and tripped you up and got you over in that mess, you still go, I bind that. I break that in Jesus' name. Father, I don't want that in my life. I command that to go. I renounce everything to do with that. I'll have no part of it. And you get back right over into the flow of glory. You don't let that, just because you tripped up with something, because you're learning. You know, and especially new Christians, you're learning how the enemy sneaks in there with his little deceiving things to try to trip you up. But you don't let that beat you down, because that's the enemy's next trick. It's if he can just beat you and beat you and beat you and beat you down and hold you under and blah, 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 because you're looking at me. You're looking at you. You've got your eyes on you and not Jesus. Amen. When you find yourself in that kind of situation, turn your eyes on Jesus. Look to the author and the finisher of your faith. Don't look in at you and say you blah, 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 because that's joining up with the enemy too. Yeah. You say, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He's washed me. He's cleansed me in his blood. I thank you, Father, that every power of darkness is broken. And Father, I want nothing to do with the enemy. Forgive me, Father, for getting tripped up again. Yeah. And you just stand up and rise up and let the Holy Ghost rise up on the inside of you. And let him take you from glory to glory. If you've been lagging, unlag right now. If you don't feel like you've been doing what you ought to be doing, lift your hands to Jesus and shout, Hallelujah. He is the one that does the work on the inside of you, not you. your pliers and your screwdrivers and your wrenches and you can get it all fixed up. It wouldn't be good enough. You must depend upon the blood of Jesus Christ. You must rely upon Him. You must rely upon the Holy Ghost. You must rely upon Him to do the work on the inside of you. One day you'll wise up and you'll get wise to the enemy's devices and you'll go, you're not pulling that trick on me again. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I'm going to trust in you. I'm going to trust in you, Father. I'm going to turn my eyes to you, Jesus. I'm going to see what you're doing, Lord Jesus. I'm not going to look to what I'm doing. See, that's where the enemy gets a place in the first place, is when people get their eyes on them and they get busy doing their own thing and then, you know, discouragement and this and that and the other comes in. I tell you what, as soon as you realize it, look, here's a key. As soon as you realize it, don't go. Don't join in with the devil and say, you loser. I'm saying this again. I know I'm saying this again. Don't join in with the devil and say, you loser, you blew it, you did it, how are you ever going to get it? How old are you going to be before you ever get it? And just join in beating yourself up. Instead, when you realize something's been going on and you need more of Jesus and it ain't been where it needs to be, lift your hands to the author. Lift your hands to the finisher. Lift your hands to the Almighty and begin to worship Him immediately. You don't have to get nowhere on your own in your own ability. You say the blood of Jesus Christ and there you're cleansed, you're washed, you're purified. And you're not going to condemn yourself. Because who wants a salvation and the world's watching you? The world is watching you, and who wants a salvation with somebody walking around with the mully grubs all the time? Somebody's looking at somebody that's got a smile on their face. There's somebody watching you and they're looking for somebody with a smile on their face, somebody with the joy of the Lord on the inside of them, somebody that's happy, somebody that doesn't look like everybody else they see.
That's
right. So if the enemy can convince you to get over there in the mully grubs about yourself, where you walk around with your head hanging down and not realizing He's the glory and the lifter of your head, then you can't effectively be a witness. So let me just make you aware of the enemy's devices right now. It's his device to make you hang your head, to make you look at yourself and beat yourself up. That's his device. The Holy Ghost's device is to put a smile on your face and joy in your heart. Father loves his children. The enemy tries to get you all upset about you. Say, Jesus loves me, this I know. For his Bible told me so. Oh, hallelujah. He loves me. Jesus loves me. He loves me. I'm his favorite child. You're like, me, his favorite child? Yes. You need to take a hold of that. You need to be like John. Like John. He said, the one whom the Lord loved. The one whom the Lord loves. He got a hold of that love and that relationship with Jesus. And John didn't look to John. John looked to Jesus. He looked, he was captivated by that love that Father had for him. He was captivated by that love that Jesus had for him. He looked to Jesus, not to his own ability, not to his self. And when we take a hold of not our ability and not ourself and not what we accomplish, but we're running to Jesus every time, every moment. We're living in the Spirit. We're walking in the Spirit. And if we get over here, we're right back over here. Because this is one place that we want to learn never to go again. Yeah. And God forbid that we ever even go there. We don't have to. We've just been taught to. We've just been so taught to live out our life, to live in the natural, to do it by our ability, to walk out with our strength, to fix everything. Yeah. They train us in school from kindergarten and what now is it 3 years old until they're grown. Mama, keep your babies home. They're trained to figure it out, to fix it, to do it on your own. They're not trained to open up their math book and say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Father, I thank you that you make my brain able to comprehend what it cannot comprehend. This is how we want to teach our children. This is how we want to train them up. We want to prepare them to be Holy Ghost people, to go to the nations of the world and not be intimidated by some kind of something that comes up. And they learn for 13, 14 years, however many long by the time you get through college, they learn all that time how to figure it out and go and study and labor and work and do all this and train yourself and stay up all night and get ready for the exam instead of relying on the anointing that you can conquer anything on earth because you can do all things through Christ Jesus. That's how we want our kids to learn, by the Holy Ghost. We want them to pray in the Holy Ghost to learn what they learn so they don't get messed up like us and continually try to fix themselves before God. Because that's what we do, because that's what we've been taught. We want to put aside man's teaching and man's learning, and we want to get over here and say it's a totally different thing. It's not an A plus or an F on a page. It's lift your hands to Jesus and let the blood of Jesus Christ do the work. It's let Him finish it. It's let Him work it out. It's let Him speak by His Spirit through you. And then you just be walking along, you know, one of those days that you're in a big hurry and you got to get things accomplished. This is, you know, happened to me the other day. I was in a big hurry. Today, I did not have time to stop and talk to anybody. I was in a big hurry. I had to hurry up and get some things done, and I had a list, and I had to work in there, going and running and getting the groceries for my daughter because she just had her baby, and she couldn't go and get the groceries, so I had to work that in. And so, buddy, she has a list a mile long, and I'm in there just trying to get all that stuff in the cart and get it all done and get checked out and get this stuff over to her house and get it delivered because I had someplace else I needed to be, and I had to hurry up. But Jesus likes it when you think you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, serving other people. And I did say, boy, I'm always taking care of people, doing something else, favors for everybody else. I'm like, I mentioned that to the Lord, but anyway, because I'm busy. And so I'm in the checkout line, and I got this pile of groceries, and there's this guy that I have ministered to again and again. I've given him a Bible and talked to him about the Lord continually when I'm in there, you know, and I've seen him, I've talked to him about the Lord, and he asked me, he says, how you doing? I said, I'm doing great. I had a new grandbaby, and I'm getting groceries for my daughter. And he goes, no, but how are you doing? I said, well, let me tell you how I'm doing. I'll tell you how I'm doing. I'm like, I am so excited. We had a little boy in our church that had a brain hemorrhage. And he's like, oh, I'm so sorry. I'm like, oh, no, don't be sorry. Because we laid our hands on him and we prayed the word of faith. We prayed over him and God healed him and God raised him up. And all of y'all know how quiet I am when I start preaching. And I'm right in front of the little stand where the guys that run the store, the managers and everybody sit. And I'm right here at this guy, and he's actually one of the managers. And, of course, you got people behind you and around you. Well, I didn't even notice. I went blank. I just totally went blank, you know, because that happens to me a lot of time when I'm preaching. I go blank, and the clock goes on, and, you know, just the Holy Ghost takes over, and I went blank. And he says, wow, that's amazing. And I said, yes, you know, I've just seen Jesus heal so many people. We just pray, and we lay our hands on people. And I started going about Jesus healing people. He goes, well, my little baby is autistic, severely autistic. And I said, God will heal your little baby. And I started telling. I said, you know, one day I laid my hands on this lady that had an inoperable brain tumor. And she was going blind. And she was having to quit her job. And the doctors had given up on her. It was inoperable. And there's nothing else they could do. She had miserable headaches all the time. And there was nothing the doctors could do. She's going blind. She's losing her life. And I laid my hands on her. And instantly God healed her. The pain left. She went back to the doctor. And the doctor said, we can't find the tumor. It's gone. And I told him about the day that Lydia, I saw Lydia. I remember she's 3 or 4 years old. Where's Lydia? I saw her. She's probably helping out. I saw her having one of these seizures, that she was having seizures repeatedly. It was continually, almost daily at this point. And the seizures would not last for just a few minutes, but they would last for like an hour, wouldn't they, Randy? They would last for an hour and even sometimes longer. And so I'm watching this baby have a seizure. And I got mad in the Holy Ghost. I got downright mad that the devil was doing that to that baby. And I said, we were down on the field. And we were having all of the Got Fun kids come out. And we were ministered to them and feeding them and had their families coming out. And we had all this work we had going on. I said, Randy and Terry, let's get down here. Let's go down here to the church because I'm sick of this. This ain't happening anymore. And we took a hold of that baby and we began to pray. And I think we were down there about 3 hours praying over Lydia. And she threw up on us and we all had to get changed and this and that and the other. And, you know, she's still having the seizure and she's like totally her neck's crooked and stuff like that. And I just, you know, going after it, yanking her head up. I'll never forget that day. I'll never forget that day because Holy Ghost said it's enough. And is there somebody willing to go after it? And so we're there about 3 hours praying over that baby. Those seizures were long because we were there for a while. And we were going after praying for that baby. And from that day forward, Lydia never had another. She never had another seizure. And it was getting to where the doctor said that this could be brain damage. If something doesn't happen, this has, something has to happen now. It has to happen. And God healed her. And I went on. I even got into Nepal and people coming on stretchers and bringing people out of the hospital. I mean, I'm preaching. He's ringing up my groceries, but he's like really slow. He goes, I like to hear stuff like this. He goes, that book you gave me is really good. I really enjoy that book. I've enjoyed that book. And he's just ringing up the groceries, and I'm just going after. He goes, but my baby didn't do anything. My baby didn't do anything to have such an affliction on it. And I said, no, your baby probably didn't. I said, but sin brings forth death. He goes, my baby didn't sin. I go, no, your baby probably didn't. I said, but what the parents and the grandparents have on them is inherited through the Spirit to your children. I said, look at the scripture where it says, was this man born blind because of the sins of his parents? And Jesus, of course, says, no, it was to show forth my glory. But I said, it's an inherited thing. I said, but the blood of Jesus Christ, and this is where I cut loose, but the blood of Jesus Christ will come and break that yoke of sin off of your life and break that yoke of sin off of your baby's life. And God will deliver it. I said, now you bring that baby. I said, you got my telephone number. You bring that baby to church. He goes, but the baby can't sit still. I said, well, we'll pray for it first. I said, you bring that baby to church, and we'll pray over your baby, and your baby will be healed. Healed. And then I wake up a little bit later, and I realize that there is nobody in the line behind me. And I look around, and it's so quiet in there. And the guy up here is watching me, and the lines are all full over here, but nobody's behind me. But I tell you what, God gave me a platform in Trader Joe's. I wasn't planning on having a platform. It's when you least expect God to do something that God will take you and he will use you and he'll put you on a platform. You could say, well, that's not a very big audience. I don't care if it was just that one man right there. The glory of God was there to be manifested to that man, and Jesus wanted that man to hear the gospel, and he's looking for a people that won't be afraid but will just open their mouth and let him feel it. Thank you, Jesus. It's not by our ability, it's by his ability. We could never come up and think of what to say. But I tell you what, the Holy Ghost knows what to say all the time. I was thinking about, you know, Kristen, when they told me, and I shared this with Trisha too, when they told me that she was missing her condyle bone, and they give me all the horrible reports about how horrible it's going to be and how her face is going to be completely distorted and her face won't grow. It'll stay right there about the size of where the baby's is, and everything will turn this way, and it's going to just, you know, blah, 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 blah. And I'm just like, you know, well, I'm going to pray about it. And then they got ugly because I said I was going to pray. They didn't like those words. Way back then, they didn't like those words. I said, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to ask God what to do. And they, you know, get out the threatenings. CPS. I got God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost on my side. You got CPS, I got God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. We'll see who's going to win. But I tell you, at the age I was a little bit shaken in my boots, you know, because they're talking about my babies. And I went home from that because they're like, you know, you've got to do this surgery. We're going to go in, we're going to take her rib, and we're going to take a piece of her rib, and then we're going to make a condyle bone, and we're going to put it in there. And so we're going to open her up here, and we're going to open her up here. And here is my tiny little skinny baby. She was a little bit taller than Anna, but she was real tiny like Anna. She's thin, real skinny. Couldn't get her to eat. Followed around all day long trying to shove food down her face. But anyway, so I went home that day, and I didn't go, oh, well, you know, what am I going to do? I put that child to bed, and I laid down on that floor, and I said, Father, I'm not getting up till I hear from heaven. If I have to stay here all night or 2 days or whatever it is, I'm going to lay here on my face before you, Father, until you hear me, until you give me an answer, because I got to know what to do, because I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. How do I come up against these doctors? What do I do, Father? And I laid down there on my face, and I began to cry out to God. I said, Father, this is my baby, and I don't want them cutting on her. They don't know what they're doing. They're idiots. Father, you created this body. You made the condyle bone. Father, you're able to put the condyle bone in her in there yourself. And I just began to cry out to God, and I continued on. And only about an hour, and I heard the Lord speak to me. And he said, I've healed her. And at any time that you see anything that would look contrary to the healing, I want you to stand up wherever you're at in any service, and I want you to declare what I have done for her. And so Father kept to his part, and I kept to my part. But we still have these doctors in the way. So I said, okay, Father, you've got to put in my mouth the words to say. And so I go, and I'm having a big meeting with the big guns. You know, they intellectually, they think they're so hot. But their wisdom is foolishness to God, amen? So they got this little girl in the corner. And the Lord rose up in me, and I so gently said, okay, I want to see every case that you know of that's ever been done with the surgery and the outcome of the surgery. I want to see it without having surgery and what the outcome is. I want to see everything. I want you to lay it all out before me, and then we'll go from there. And they went, well, you know, she is kind of little. She's kind of tiny, and maybe we should wait till she gets a little bigger. I said, that's what I've been saying. I took my baby, and I got away from those doctors, and I didn't go anywhere near them so they could say anything to me. I learned when they said, you need to get a second opinion and you need to go to somebody, because it was the dentist that said, she's missing her condyle bone, I want you to go over here. So I'm like, go over here, you know, Miss Condyle Bone, what's going on? I don't know. But I tell you what I learned then, I'm not going to go find out. Because they're not in control, God's in control. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you, Father, that she's fine. God healed her. All we need to do is trust in the Lord. I'd like to show Brian right now. I'd like you guys to see what happens when a church prays. This is Brian right here in the blue shirt. He's at the hospital. He's on the playground. He's in the blue shirt. He's running around. Now, I don't know if you understand about a brain hemorrhage, but my mother had a major brain hemorrhage. And the doctors, and he's riding a little tricycle right here. Look what the Lord has done! Look what the Lord has done! He healed my body. He saved my soul. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, my God.
Only Jesus. The doctor's like, you're one lucky boy. And Trisha said, no, the Lord preserved my son. And another come in and goes, where's the miracle boy? Where's the miracle boy? And then she hears the nurses over behind the curtain. They had pulled the curtain because Brian needed to do something. They need to do something with Brian. And the nurse says, whatever deity they're praying to works, because this doesn't happen.
And one of the nurses pops up and goes, it's Jesus. They're praying to Jesus. And they said, well, it is working. Because we have never seen anybody come out of a brain hemorrhage. And Allie can tell you, come out of a brain hemorrhage without damage. It is damage to the brain. But we said no. But we said no in Jesus' name. When I was down on my face praying about that, and I thought, Lord, you know, probably a bunch of people are praying the same prayer. While he was in surgery, I was praying, Father, I thank you that you send your angel to take over. And they don't even know what's going on, but you send your angel to take over. And I mean, I felt the presence of that angel as I was praying. Because see, the Holy Ghost tells you what to pray. You don't know what you ought to pray, but the Holy Ghost knows what to pray. And I said, send your angel to take over and fix it all up. And there's going to be no problem. There's going to be no damage in Jesus' name, because your angel's going to come. Hallelujah. I mean, I don't know how many were praying that same prayer, but I know God uses many people to pray that. Emily said that God put that on her heart, too, to pray. Thank you, Jesus. You know, we just touch heaven. A praying church breaks the yoke. And I'm so thankful for a praying church. Well, they thought they were going to send him home yesterday, and at the latest today is what they were thinking, but they found out yesterday that the doctors want to go back in tomorrow morning and finish fixing what they didn't finish fixing. And so I've been praying for that not to happen. And we sent out an email today asking everybody to pray with us that something just happens, that can't happen, that doesn't happen. You know, they got all their reasons that they said why they got to go in and do it, that they didn't finish, and that, you know, they had planned to do it all along. But you're looking at a boy that God healed. And so we need to pray, church. We need to pray throughout this evening and tonight that God's glory will be seen and revealed through this thing. Because, you know, of course, his father wants to have it done. And the doctors are persistent that it has to be done. And so Trish is standing with the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost and with this church praying and believing for this thing to be turned around in Jesus' name. And I want you guys to really take that to prayer, because it's so exciting to see what God's done. This is what God's called us to, church. This is what he's called us to. He's called us to live out and to walk out his glory. He said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. And this is all the world right here in San Diego. You don't have to pick up and go somewhere else, because you got the world all around you. If everybody around you's a Christian, they're saved and they're full of the Holy Ghost, then you can move on to the next place. But until then, you got plenty to do right where you're at. You don't have to pick up and go anywhere. You have a big job right here in San Diego to declare the glory of God. Praise you, Jesus. I mean, it's exciting. You know, Bobby, I sent Bobby up there to the hospital a lot because I couldn't go, you know, up there very much. And I sent her up there, and she had the opportunity to lay her hands on babies in intensive care. This one baby, they were getting ready to pull the plug. She wanted to try to pray for it, but the mom wouldn't let them in. But, you know, those that are willing and saying, please come my way. So she had several opportunities to pray for people. And it's so exciting, you know, to see what the church is doing. You know, Cindy was sharing with me the other day that she went to the dentist. And she got a new dentist and just started going to him and was getting her tooth fixed. And the dentist was getting in there and saying, oh, this looks like it's going to be a root canal because I'm getting too close to the nerve. And Cindy goes, stop. She's like going like this, and she goes like, stop. She goes, now I want you to agree with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, I command that this tooth just be very simple, and it's not a root canal. We're not having a root canal. And I thank you, Father, that it's just going to be a very simple feeling in Jesus' name. She goes, now you can go ahead. And they're like, okay, that's different. Guarantee you never had a patient do that before. But the glory of God, when we will just open our mouths simply, they have to go home and think about that. They'll never forget that. And it wasn't a root canal. It was just a very simple feeling. God took over. When you open your mouth, the Lord is just saying, who is on my side? Open your mouth and declare the glory. Open your mouth and declare his glory. Live it, walk it out, be who he is. Be who he is. Because he's on the inside of you. living in Him and Him in us. Hallelujah. We don't have to ascend up to heaven to bring Christ down. He is nigh thee. In your heart and in your mouth, speak it out. Open your mouth, speak it out. You know that, you know, that's first quoted in Deuteronomy chapter 30, and then quoted again in Romans 10, 8 and 9. And they're always thinking that somebody's got to, there's got to be a prophet or somebody that goes up and takes this in God and brings it down. You know, that same mindset when Paul spoke it in Romans, that same mindset, who's going to ascend up and bring God down? Nobody needs to ascend up. He's nigh thee, even in your heart and in your mouth. Just declare His word and He'll perform it. You just stand as His ambassador that He's called you to be, and He will perform His work in you and through you if you will just allow Him to. Allow Him to. And prepare yourself. Say, Father, I want to be used of You. Father, I don't want to just speak a little phrase, a little simple, Jesus loves you. I mean, that's good. If that's all you say, the power and the anointing can be right behind it. But Father, I want to declare You glory. Yeah. I want to speak boldly of the things that You've done. I want to preach about the blood of Jesus Christ like Pastor Geneva was in Trader Joe's. I said, the blood of Jesus Christ will set you free or break all that bondage off of you. Hallelujah. I like preaching about the blood. Everybody's probably wondering around blood. They don't have a clue, but it's that blood of Jesus Christ that He shed for us to bring us over into that relationship with the Father. That's what broke that cut that veil in two and opened up that place of holies so we could enter in. Hallelujah. Praise You, Father. We worship You, Jesus. Glory to Your name, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. We thank You, Father, for what You have done. I haven't even opened my Bible yet to get started. Praise You, Jesus. I tell you what, there's a lot of miracle working people in this place because you're full of the Holy Ghost. And God's called you to not live a humdrum life, not to be boring, and just live out your life trying to figure it out. What is it going to profit you if you gain the whole world and end up losing your soul? Because if you get your focus on gaining this world, if your focus is on what you can obtain in this world, then you will end up most likely losing your own soul. He's called us out of living our own life. He's called us over into that place of glory, of living His life, Him living on the inside of us, and Him showing forth His glory. And you know, we hear Pastor Mark talking about William Branham, and you know, a lot of us have read Smith Wigglesworth and John G. Lake and Mariah Woodworth Eder and Catherine Kuhlman, and we could just go on and on, Oral Roberts and all the men and women of God that God's used, and I mean, how He's even used us in this place. And it should stir our hearts to know that if God can do it with one person, He can do great things in us if we'd just be willing to say, yes, Lord. If, like I said at the beginning, if you'll stay out of beating yourself up and just learn to go over into praising the Lord and go deeper. See, because you're going to have trials. You're going to have these things that come against you. And we're going to turn right there real quick to 1 Peter chapter 1. There's going to be those things that come out against you. Wherefore you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you are in heaviness through manifold temptations. Now listen. For the trial of your faith, being much more precious than that of gold, of all the monetary things that you can obtain and acquire, much more precious than gold,
that perisheth.
It's all gonna, you're not gonna take it with you. If you go by the way of the grave, everything that you've worked for to earn, to have, to store up for yourself is gonna stay here, and somebody else is gonna enjoy it and not you.
And a lot of people end up leaving it to the government because they didn't know how to handle their finances. Though it be tried with fire.
See, hear that fire? People are like, you know, you get in a situation and you're just like, this is just, you know, this is ridiculous. It's too much. I can't handle it. I can't bear it. It's called fire.
It's called fire for a reason. There's some melting and some molding. He didn't make you the potter. He made you the clay. That way he could work on you. And there's some squeezing and bending and twisting and redoing. And first, before you get that, when you get that clay off the riverbank and you get that good clay, it's got to be thrown through a screen again and again to get all the glass and all the rocks and all the trash out, get all the weeds out, get the garbage out. You ever feel like you've been thrown through a screen? Rejoice, because the potter is fashioning you. He's beginning the work. He's working on you. He wants to put you on the wheel and bend you all over the place. He's getting you ready. So when you get on that wheel, you're not going to crack and you're not going to break. You're not going to get off. You're not going to have to be thrown off the wheel because there's still trash in there. You know, I remember fires, and I still remember, and I know fires that I've gone through in my life. But I remember times going, okay, I'm done. I'm cooked. I went out of this one. I'm just so done. Oh, the sweet presence of Jesus. When you learn that sweet presence of Jesus, that's right there in the midst of the fire. When you learn and you take a hold of, when you count it all joy, for James chapter 1, when you count it all joy, when you're in those diverse trials and temptations, you count it all joy because you know the Father is going to show up. And you know when you get to the other side, there's an increase in the anointing. There's an increase in authority. There's an increase in your life to walk with God. You feel that increase. You know that increase because you are willing to walk through that fire and not be burned. You are willing to be like the Hebrew children. The Hebrew children, they went in willingly. It may have been like, okay, those big guys picked them up and threw them in. But they stood there and they said, O King, be it known unto you. They could have done what it took. We'll bow and then we'll go and repent. Or whatever. You know, people try to figure that out. You know, and some of the Christian people have tried that out with ISIS. I don't know if you guys have heard those stories that they've tried that out with ISIS, and they denied the name of Jesus, and they, you know, praised Allah, and then they shot him immediately. As soon as they denied the name of Jesus, they're like, oh, well, you're worthless, you're a traitor, boom. I don't know how many of you've heard that. I watched those stories on YouTube where they just killed them. So it does you a lot of good to deny Jesus, then you go straight to hell. But I mean, you know, some people, you know, they want to take the chicken road. They don't want to take the highway. The highway is go through the fire. The highway is to go through the trial. The highway is to say, here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. Take all of me. Take all of me. You make that commitment, and then the fire gets big, and you go, this is too much. You know, and it isn't that long ago that I said, well, Lord, that's intense, and I don't want to go through that. And then I just feel the presence of Jesus, and I just go, anything for you, Lord. I love you so much, Jesus, that if this is what you want, Father, you know, it may be something that you see as a demonic assignment, but yet in it, God's trying your heart. You're going to trust me. You're going to walk through whatever I tell you to walk through. Anything for you, Jesus. Lord, this one's as tough as nails, but anything for you, Jesus, I'll do it because you'll help me, I know, because I've done it so many times. I've walked through it so many times. I've counted all joy. I got a hold of counting it all joy. And Father, I want to live in counting it all joy because I know, Father, that you will give me the strength and you will help me and you will enable me to bear it. You will enable me to bear it. I can do this.
because I'm not relying on me anymore. I'm not looking at my circumstances anymore. I'm not figuring it out anymore. I trust in you. I tell you, people, it is time right now. Now is the time. Yesterday is the time to learn to trust God, to learn to walk in faith, to learn to look at your mountain and say, be removed and cast into the sea. To look at your mountain of finances and say, I speak to you, come. You know, some of us may settle out for just what it takes to have what we have. And we could go deeper and speak for more money and more finances for the kingdom. But I tell you what, just get the fact of walking straight with God before you get so worried about finances for the kingdom. Just be willing to go through the fire and not be burned. Just be willing to say, Father, whatever you desire to do with me to make me that person that you can use for your glory. See, if you don't go through the fire, if you don't learn it now, when the things really get tough in our nation, in our country, or if God sends you to a nation like North Korea where it's really crazy, you won't know how to trust him and believe him. Well, he's not going to send you to North Korea. You're going to get up and go if you go there, if you haven't learned how to trust him. It's you know, starting out that you have to get through to be able to get to those places. You have to be able to trust him. And Father is taking you there. If you will just let him, if you will let him, it's easy to sing the song, I surrender all, or here I am. I love that song, take all of me. I pour out myself on you, Jesus. He's worthy. Look what he's done for us. He poured out himself for us. He first loved us. We didn't first love him. He first loved us and gave himself for us. And he's caused us to love him. And that's why when it's, you know, I've had those few times where I just went, do not want, you know, and I'm talking about, you know, in the last few years where I had learned a long time ago to count it all joy when you run through, walk through the trials. But those times where, you know, okay, this is demonic assignment from hell, and I just break it, bind it and everything, and the Lord goes, I want you to do this, and I'm just like, but then his presence, and I'm like, anything for you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. And I mean, I, that's just me and God in a secret place. I'm in bed at night and he's talking to me and I got my hands raised in the air. I love you, Jesus. I love you so much, Father. If this is what you want, Lord. If this is what you want. Because we don't want to deny his name.
No, we don't.
We want to lift up his name. Look what he's done for us. Every one of us could just begin to count the miracles that he's done for us. I mean, I think sometimes we need to just go home and write them all down. Just begin to write down everything God's done for you. Just begin to share what God's done for you. Begin to tell people how he healed you. What he's done to you for you. And I mean, that should keep you shouting all day long. Singing his praises. And if he can do all of these things that you're looking at that he's already done for you, why can't he do whatever he's asking of you right now? When he's saying, come out and go over here to a place that I will show you. And you're saying, whoa, that's too big. Go read what he's already done for you. Go begin to look at all of those things and say, he is able. He is more than able. And so therefore, I'm able to go up. We're able to take the city. We're able to be Joshua and Caleb. We're able to do this. Amen. We are able. Amen. I think everybody needs to say that so we can make sure we all get on the same. We are able. We are able. Because he's able. I can, not I can't. I can do. I'm a can do, not a can't do. I'm a can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can go through this battle and I can win. I can come out. I can on the other side doing it just like Jesus would do it. See, that's what he requires for us to go through it and do it like he did it. He requires that.
Yes.
We can go right back to what is the greatest commandment. And I went over this with my grandkids last week when I was keeping all four of them. I was like, what is the greatest commandment? What is most important to the Father above everything? What is the greatest commandment? To silence. Love the Lord your God. Let's read the one in Mark chapter 12. They come, here was, I like this one. There's another one where they ask them the same thing in Matthew. But I like this one because I just like it all. But anyway, I love this. But, and one of the scribes comes to him, chapter 12, verse 28, and had heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, says, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one God. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And the second one's likened unto it. The second one's like it. The second one's the same thing, because it's proof that you love the Lord. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. With all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your might, your strength, with everything that's within you, all of your strength, like David danced before the Lord with all of his strength. He put everything he had into it. He put his intellect, his understanding, his thinking. This is how we're to love the Lord, with our intellect, our understanding, our thinking, our soul, our spirit. Everything that's within us. God is first. This is seeking first the kingdom of God, because if you love the Lord, God Almighty, like he's commanded us to, and he paved the way for us to be able to, through the blood of Jesus Christ, to really live this out and walk this out through the Spirit, because by our ability, we can't do anything. We have to be totally reliant upon him and our neighbor as ourself. And the scribe said unto him, well, Master, thou hast said the truth. For there is one God, and there is none other but he. And to love him with all your heart and with all your understanding and with all your soul and with all of your strength, and to love your neighbor as himself, is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. It's everything. It's more than all that you can give to God. People want to come up here and give and feel like, and God, he requires that our relationship. For number one, your tithe is your commitment with God. Your tithe is that you have a covenant with God. He's your God and you're his child. That's covenant. Offerings are love offerings of worship, worshiping the Lord for what he has done, and because you love him, and because he asked it of you, and you just love him, so you do it. It's relationship and fellowship. One is covenant, the other is relationship and fellowship. You don't want to mess with covenant. You want to keep covenant. Another covenant is being in the house of God every time the door is open, and that's covenant, covenant relationship. He's your God, and you're his child. And it's just, this is who I am. I come running. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, come to the house of the Lord. But people want to make it a ritual and come up and, and do their part. I gave to the church down the road. I went to church on Easter and on Christmas. I did my dues. I should get into heaven. I'm a good person. Has nothing to do with that. It's the blood of Jesus Christ. It has nothing to do with what you give. It's all about you living out a covenant relationship and keeping that covenant. And the most important thing is that you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your being, with everything that's within you, with all your strength. You love him. And the amazing thing is he enables you to, because he first loved us. We love him because he first loved us. And that's in 1 John chapter 4. It starts out, well, it doesn't start out, but in 7 it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, does not know God. He that does not love his brother does not know God. It's the proof in the pudding. I was telling my grandkids, I'm like, if you say that you love God and you hate your brother, if you get in, you know, because I had to work through some things, you get in an argument with your brother, you hit your sister. You know, these are not manifestations of loving them more than you love yourself, because you wouldn't come up and slap yourself in the face. You're not going to do it. Unless, you know, kids are kidding around or whatever, but you're not going to hurt yourself on purpose. Love is the proof that we are in God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. I'm like, we can't just say that we're Christians. We can't just say that we know Him and that we're the holy saints of God and not have the proof in the pudding. He put the proof there. He sent His Son. He loved us so much. He gave the proof. Jesus showed up. He died a horrible death, and He rose again. He put the proof there. Now He enabled you to have the proof there. And it's us in our yielding to Him, being willing to allow Him to form us and fashion us in His image and in His likeness, to perfect everything in us. Us being willing to say, I'm His, and I surrender when it's tough. As I said, tough as nails. You know, just try to bite on a nail. That's pretty tough. When it's tough for us, we're saying, Lord, whatever You want, because I love You, Lord. I love You, Lord. Here I am. Take all of me. I'll hold nothing back. Nothing back. Are you really letting Him in every closet and holding nothing back? Are you letting Him all the way down to those deep places of your emotion that it, you know, there's times when you're in the trial that it really hurts. You feel the pain. It feels like it's too much. It feels like, you know, God, how can You require this of me? How can this happen? Do you really let Him go deep down in there? Or do you hold it back so you can go around and try to learn that one again? Because when you don't pass, you know what? I don't care where you live on this earth. I don't care what church you go to and how many times you change churches. You're going to go through the fire. If you're going to continue to walk with God, you're going to go through the fire and you're going to win. So you might as well just win now through Jesus Christ. You're going to go through it until you surrender it. Yeah. It may be a few years down the road and God says there's got to be a lot of maturing going on before they can go through this one again. Because they said with their mouth, but their heart was far from Me. Oh, Lord Jesus. We don't want that said about any of us. Because He's going to split the eastern skies any day now. I know there could be a lot of things that need to happen, but He could come at any moment. I'm staying right there with Paul. He's going to split those eastern skies and we're going to be changed in a moment in a twinkling of an eye. This mortality is going to put on immortality, and we're going to meet Him in the clouds. And there we will ever be with the Lord. And then He's going to say to all of those that were counted worthy to escape those things which shall come upon the earth, He is going to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. We're going to hear those words. And we want to be ready at every moment. We don't want to hold anything back. We don't want there to be anything. We don't want pride, that ugly, stinking, rotten thing that took Satan down, that took that anointed cherub down. He began to be lifted up in his heart with arrogance and pride. And that thing worked in his spirit until he said, I will ascend before God. And all men will worship Me until this day He is working that. And He is ruthlessly going after every man, woman, boy, or girl that He can. And through the internet, He's having His way through children continually. He is taking a hold of them in the formative years of their brain, when their brain's being formed, and He's bringing forth His death in all of that, in the media, through television. People, separate your kids from that. Know what they're seeing. Know what they're watching. They don't need that mess. It'd be better to raise your kids on a farm where, you know, People are just like, oh, my kids are really wanting a smartphone. I said, well, they don't need one. And anybody is cracked in the head to give a kid a smartphone. I said, if you've got to give them a phone, give them one of those things that you can barely dial out. And it's restricted to your number and the dad's number or whatever. Hallelujah. They don't need that garbage. I didn't have one when I was their age. And I survived. I am standing here right now. I didn't have one of those things till I was 30-something years old. And the first one was like this big. You had to hold it like this and put it up to your ear. I mean, it was huge. They started in the car, and it was this big, huge phone. And we survived. We did fine without it. And I mean, you know, the texting's killed more people than anything else now in our nation. I think isn't that number one? People texting, kids texting. And so you just want to hurry up and give your kids one of those so when they learn to drive, they can text while they're driving, and they will. I remember yanking the phone from Kristen's hands going, you're not doing that while you're driving. I am still your mother. And you're not doing that. And I mean, she was over 21. But I'm still her mother. And she'll tell you that. I will still boss her. And she is married and we gave her away and I will still boss her. She's my daughter. But I'm going to tell her because I love her. You know, you're going to speak those things into your children's lives. I mean, love is not handing them something that's going to damn their soul to hell. You know, what are you thinking? Get over in the Holy Ghost and start praying. Kids don't need that stuff, and half the people in here don't need that stuff. Saps up your time that you could be alone with the Lord. Because, you know, something I learned a long time in ministry, and I'm way over here, but something I learned a long time ago in ministry is people will suck up all of your time. Not that we don't minister to people, because we do, but people have to learn to walk with God, because there's people that will constantly text you, you know, should I open the door, should I close the door, should I eat now, should I not eat now, should I, you know, is ice cream bad? I see you, Baskin Robbins, and I really want to go in, can I go in? You know, just whatever, and I'm saying, you know, that may be a little bit of an exaggeration, but not much. And if you answer all of that back, you're just going to be, you know, and where's the time with Jesus? You know, because people will just come in. People got to learn to walk with Jesus. You know, there's a time, like if you get ready and you're just like, okay, God called me to go to Mesopotamia or somewhere and told me to get up and go to the island of Crete and just whatever. And so we're packing up the house and we're leaving tomorrow. That you definitely need to run through leadership. That one, don't start packing until you talk to those that are over you in the Lord that are watching for your soul. But ice cream, if you want it, go eat it and pray over it, whatever, you know. And try to cut the sugar. The sugar's bad. Sin's bad, sugar's bad. They both start with an F. And so you don't need those time wasters. We've got so much that's going on everywhere. And we need those people that are getting along with God in that secret place and are coming out with the glory and the power of God. Not those that can like every single thing on Facebook. And you're just like, my word, how in the world did anybody get time to like that much stuff? Did they read it all or did they just go through? I mean, that's a lot of reading. I wonder if they read the Daily Bread. They didn't like that one, nor did they post it on their Facebook. I'm like, I'm seeing a lack of people posting the Daily Bread on their Facebook page. Pastor Mark puts it out there so we can post it and we can share it with people that don't get the Daily Bread. But anyway, seems like that would be priority, right? Right?
Yeah.
You can say ouch. And oh me, because I didn't. Well, Mike doesn't have Facebook, and he's saying ouch anyway. Oh, thank you, Jesus. But, it's so rich in Deuteronomy chapter chapter 6 and chapter 10 and chapter 30, where the foundation of the scripture was taken, where the God who is the same yesterday and today and forever, who never changes, when he walked on the earth, he healed the sick and raised the dead and cast out devils. The Almighty, who is the same, where he first pronounced it in Deuteronomy chapter 6, that we have it written down to be brought over here into Matthew and to Mark chapter 12, to love the Lord your God and the promises that he put there. You know, people want to do away with the Old Testament, but Jesus came to fulfill the law. And if we go over and we look into Romans, we see Romans chapter 13, we see that when you love, because love does no evil or any harm to its neighbor, when you love like that, then that is the fulfillment of the law, because Jesus came to fulfill the law, not to do away with the law. He came to do away with your works and your ability. He came to do away with man's ability and to give you and impart his spirit within you so you could walk out the law and the love and the righteousness of God by the Spirit. But everybody wants to do away with the Old Testament and have God anyway. And now they're trying to do away with the New Testament and explain John and everybody else away with the passion that they had to walk with God and teaching to walk free from the powers of darkness. They want to do away with it. They start with one part and then they go for it all. And then they have a form of some kind of a cultish religion. And the power and the presence of God is so far from him. He left a long time ago. He's not there. They still may have a microphone, but the presence of God is far gone. All you have is intellectualism and emotionalism. I want the power and the presence of God. So I want to go all the way back to Deuteronomy chapter 6 and look at that. And we're just going to go, it's not going to take that long. Verse 5, and thou shalt love, we'll start with 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. And let's just run over here to chapter 10, verse 12. And now, Israel, what doth the Lord your God require of you? What does God require? God requires this of you. He's enabled you by his Spirit, but he requires this of you. What does the Lord require of you? But to fear the Lord your God. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, arrogance, and the evil way. God hates those things. The fear of the Lord is to hate every evil thing, every lie and deception of the enemy. Who wants to be on the enemy's side anyway? Why go there? Why let his stuff come out of your mouth? Why allow his works to come through your eyes or into your ear, the thoughts out of your spirit? We don't want his evil works. We want to guard against them. And love is the foundation. If you will take a hold of it, you will walk this out with God and you will see a change in your life. If you will take a hold of what is the most important thing to God. Because if you love him, you're going to love your neighbor as yourself, because he requires it of you. And when you're totally given over to him, it's going to come out of you. And you won't want to do any harm to your neighbor because you love him. Because Jesus took it to another step in John chapter 13. He says, and a new commandment I write unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you and have given myself for you.
Yeah.
That love that goes all the way to the cross. How far do you go for your neighbor? All the way to the cross. And I ask the kids, I'm like, who is your neighbor? And they're like, anybody we're around. I'm like, you get that faster than adults do. Adults are like, the person next door. I don't ever talk to them, so I'm not required too much. They never come over. We don't bother each other. They come in, I never see them. Anybody that's around you. They started pointing around to everybody. I'm like, exactly. Exactly. You're to love everyone you're around to the point that you will go to the cross for them. That love. Can you do that on your own ability? Absolutely not. But can the Holy Spirit enable you to? The Holy Spirit can enable you to not defend yourself, to shut your mouth, to go, I'm not going there. the enemy has tricked me too many times. He's trapped me with that one too many times. I've done that one too many times. And, you know, hey, you can try what I did. I bit my tongue till I felt like it was going to bleed. I'm like, you know what? You're staying right there in your mouth, in my mouth, and you ain't saying nothing. I'm clamping down. And I've done it. I'm like, I need a clamp. Because I'm feeling a rebuttal right now. I'm feeling like saying something. And I don't feel like it's the Holy Ghost. I know it's not. So I need to keep that tongue in its place right now because it's not flowing in the Spirit. So clamp down real hard. I didn't say anything. I was not saying anything. It works. You know, a little bit of pain. Sometimes you need some to wake you up. This is what Father requires of you. He requires this of you. But to fear the Lord, thy God, to walk in his ways and to love him and to serve the Lord, thy God, with all your heart and with all your soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command you this day for your good, for your good. And I tell you, when you really love the Lord, you're going to keep the commandments. It just flows out of you. And you know how you really love the Lord? You allow him to do his work in you.
Hallelujah.
You allow him, because he's right there going, do not say that. Don't do that. And how many times do we go right ahead? A couple of weeks ago, the Holy Spirit spoke something to me. And he just, you know, be still. And I had to get that one more thing said. The spanking was not too pleasant. And I'm like, Lord, I want to follow the Holy Spirit all the time. He speaks so softly, so gently. He bids us to come. The enemy is so forceful and so screaming and so yelling. And he comes up with such brilliant things he throws at your head. And I mean, he doesn't need to help many of us very much, because we can come up with it ourselves. But he's there egging you on. Go ahead, say it. Go ahead, you deserve it. They deserve it. We all deserve it. Just let it out and get this thing dealt with. Let's just settle this once and for all. I mean, all kinds of bright, good ideas to slip you up to get in there and, you know, defend yourself and to fix things up. And everyone in this place could raise their hand and say, you've done it. Because there's been a lack of temperance, self-control. Because we haven't yielded ourselves to the Spirit. You know, if we can tame the tongue, bridle the tongue, then we're a perfect man indeed. The tongue. We want it set on fire by the Holy Ghost and not of hell. Amen? We want to yield it up to the Holy Ghost. When the enemy's yelling at you to start to, you know, to defend yourself and self-justify yourself and fix things for yourself, start praying in the Holy Ghost, and Satan will get out of there so fast. I mean, he flees. When you submit yourself to God, you resist the devil by praying in the Holy Ghost. He's out of there. He does not like to hang around a tongue talker. He doesn't like to hang around the presence of the Holy Ghost. He won't. The Bible says he flees. He does. He's not hanging around. You want the enemy off you? Start worshiping God.
Yeah.
Just get in a Holy Ghost dance and start shouting and praising his holy name. Say, instead of the enemy using me to open my mouth and say something, do something, defend myself, fix something, figure it out for myself, I'm going to pray in the Holy Ghost. You know, I don't know how to do anything. I don't know how to go in and come out. I remind myself of that continually. Lord, I know that I've got a brain up here somewhere. But I know that your way is higher in everything that I do. And Lord, show me to do it your way. Just continually. Because I'll get busy about the day and I'm like, this is what we need to do. Let's get it going. Let's get it doing. And then I'm like, okay, Father, I've had a lot of brilliant ideas. Lord, forgive me. Holy Spirit, what are you saying, doing? I want to be still. I want to hear you. Because out of that simple obedience of an everyday walk with God, he will give you platforms to declare his glory and to speak his word. And just listening to the Holy Spirit, and it will bubble up out of your belly like a river. Hallelujah. And it will bring change. You know, we're not responsible totally for what happened to the seed that we sow. We're to sow liberally. We are to make disciples, but we're still to sow liberally everywhere we go. And Father will take care of that seed. He will protect it. But we want the words that we're sowing, because we're going to reap them. We want them to be life everlasting. Amen. We want to be what's going to encourage somebody. What if you said something that was just a little too much for somebody else and it pushed them over the edge and they couldn't take anymore, and it was just, you went too far with them. And of course, it's their decision to allow themselves to be devastated so much that they turned their back on God or whatever, because they just had enough, because they just didn't know how. But in turn, you could have loved it on them and encouraged them, because they were slipping and they needed you to pull them on over into the realms of glory. They needed you to bring that word of encouragement. The Bible says exhort one another daily, not whap each other in the head daily. Bring that encouragement that's going to bring people to a deeper place. You see somebody that's going through a battle and it seems like, you know, they're a dunderhead. Well, be careful that you don't say that, because they're the servant of the Most High God, and you don't want to speak over a child of God like that. Because if they're in church and they're putting forth that commitment and that effort to walk with God, you want to be there to be encouragement to them and bring them up and lift them up to that place that God's called them to be. You want to exhort them, encourage them, and bring them over into the realms of glory. Love on them. There's some people that, you know, there's the weak ones among us. And there's just extra love that needs to go out. And if we can't love the strong ones, how can we love the weak ones? And here I go back on love. But you know what? What is the greatest commandment? And the second one's like unto it. And if we can't get this down, then we, people will not look at us and say, they are the disciples of Jesus Christ. I think they were praying to Jesus. It was Jesus over there. And we see it. We see the manifestation by the love they have one for another. We love that abiding place, because we go in there and people, they don't little, you know, have little groupies that, you know, you can't be a part of. They so openly love everyone, and they're so welcoming.
Amen.
And they're so surround us with their love. We know that they're the disciples of Jesus. We may not like to go over there, because then we can't do what we want to do. Because there's been men and people that come in here and they hear the gospel. And they know if they stay here, they have to repent and change, and they don't want to. And I've heard them say it. And I've seen it happen over and over again. They don't want to change. But I thank God for every person that's sitting in this seat, because it means you want to change.
Amen.
It means you want to change. You want to live out the word of God. You don't want to live out the lies that the enemy is breathing out throughout the church world today, that you can do whatever you're going to do and the blood of Jesus Christ will excuse it because you're just a man. But you want to live. You want to be like. I didn't get finished with all of this I want to go to, but here we have to go over to 1 John. Real quick. It's those nights that you think you have not very much to say and it's only going to take 15 minutes. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3. And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. Hereby we do know. This is the proof in the pudding.
Yeah.
It's really the stuff. You got it. You're in him if we keep his commandments. It's the proof. Everyone can read the epistle that you live and go, she or he is a child of God. He that says, I know him, and keeps not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. He that says he loves God and hates his brother is a liar. You can't do it on your own ability, but you can by the Holy Spirit. You must be completely dependent upon him every moment. That is your key. That is the answer. Don't anybody sit here and get out the hammer. I feel the hammer coming out, and people are whacking themselves in the head. Oh, me, oh, my. Look to the author and the finisher of your faith.
Christ Jesus. Lift up your head. Your redemption draws nigh. He's the glory and the lifter of your head. He is able. I can through Him, through the Spirit, by the Spirit. I can. So, okay. Done with your ability, His ability.
Yes.
Done with you, Him. Just yield. Just yield yourself to Him. But whosoever keepeth His word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby we know that we are in Him. Because we don't talk about it. It's not that we show up to church. It's not that we carry a Bible around with us everywhere we go. It's not that we name the name, but it's that we live the life. We're obedient to His word. I don't care who your mama was, who your daddy was, who your grandpappy was, or who anybody was in your line, in your inheritance. It's who are you. I don't care what church you go to. It's who are you. Do you have that relationship? Do you walk with Him? Do you obey Him? Do you keep His commandments? That's what Father's saying. Do you have that relationship, or are you too busy for Him? Because you're too caught up in your life. Again, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And everything that you have need of, it's going to be added to you. And then it's going to be a blessing and not a curse. And you can go in and you can read Deuteronomy chapter 30. And then you can take Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, where it talks about love your neighbor as yourself. And you can just, you know, get caught up in going from scripture to scripture about this. Because in Romans chapter 13, verse 8 through I think it's 14, just laying out, like so completely laying out the fulfillment of the law. It hangs on love. Because when you love your neighbor, you're not going to do those things to them. You would never do those things to yourself. You're not going to do it to anyone else. It's who you are because you love, because you receive the love of God. Well, I just thank you, Father, for the nation shakers in this place, Father, that you are putting the deposit of your Spirit in so mightily that they will stand valiantly for you, that they will not look to the arm of the flesh, they will not look to their ability to walk out anything with you, but they will look to you, Jesus. I thank you, Father, that you will work it in their spirit, you work it in their heart, oh God. That they love you so much, Father God, there is nothing that you can't have. Yes. There's absolutely nothing you can't have here, Father. David, there's absolutely nothing you can't have here, Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Jesus, for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. We thank you, Father God. We give ourselves to you, Lord, afresh and anew. And Lord, if it takes 5 times a day, 10 times a day, Lord Jesus, you said that we're to forgive 70 times and that in a day. So Father, we know that we have that reciprocation from you. And whatever it takes, we're staying in the program. And we're not going to look to our ability or to ourselves, but we're going to look to you, Jesus. Amen. Looking unto Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Everybody stand with me. We praise you, Father. Now, if there's anybody in here, if you're sick, if you need something from God, if you need a financial miracle, whatever you need, you're not coming up here and presenting yourself to me. You're coming up here and you're presenting yourself to the Father. It has nothing to do with me. I'm strictly a vessel that is willing to say, here I am, Lord, just like you. But you can present yourself to the Father. And as you do, I want everyone to take that covenant relationship that you have with Jesus. If you have tithe in your pocket and it belongs to God, I want you to take that covenant relationship. Or if you have an offering to come and worship the Lord and just praise His holy name with, I want you to do that as you come before His presence right now in Jesus' name. So get your worship of offering ready. And anyone that wants prayer, I'll be glad to pray with you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. And sing this song with us.